nation. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Today the scripture comes from Philemon. This is a letter written by Paul. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apaphe, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith toward the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love because the heart of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel, but I prefer to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me, even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say.
Let us hear these words from Luke's account of the Gospel, the 14th chapter, beginning with the 25th verse and reading through the 33rd verse. Now large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then while the other is still far away, He sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions. This is the written word of God for all of God's people.
Thanks be to God.
In July, I attended the consecration service for the four newly elected United Methodist bishops in the North Central jurisdiction held in Peoria. I've never been to a service of consecration for bishops, and given the location of the service changes from time to time for this every 4 years event, I have no idea whether or when I will ever go and attend one again. So I was excited. I was pretty revved up about this. It was especially exciting having witnessed two of the four elections by live stream and having watched all four of their brief post-election speeches, as well as knowing the likelihood that one of these four brand new bishops would likely be our bishop. Sanctuary was full, the organ was majestic, and the music was moving, and the people were filled with joy and excitement. And as all of the active bishops in the North Central jurisdiction, along with many of those retired, as well as the four about to be consecrated, processed into the sanctuary, I could hardly sing the hymn. I could hardly do it for the tears in my eyes and my choking voice. I was beginning to wonder if the people around me wondered what was the matter with me that had just happened. It was a very powerful moment, the church, the larger church, worshiping at its best. But there was another moment I will remember just as well. When it was time to examine the four to be consecrated, Bishop Gregory Palmer stepped to the center of the chancel. Some of you will remember that Bishop Palmer was our bishop from 2008 to 2012. And the moment I remember occurred when, facing those four, he came to the line which read, "Your joy will be to follow Jesus the Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve." And somewhere in the middle of that line, I don't remember exactly where it was, Bishop Palmer's voice began to break. And his face began to quiver, and his eyes started to fill with tears, and he literally stopped. I've never seen Bishop Palmer at a loss for words, but with the words written clearly in front of him in black and white, he stood there and stopped as though he might not. But he took out his handkerchief and he began to wipe his eyes and his forehead and his face. And after pulling himself back together, he went on, still visibly moved by something in those words. And I began to wonder just what it was. What was it? It happens to me now and again. Usually it's when a bride comes down the aisle, or I'm standing at the baptismal font, holding a baby so close I can feel how holy she is. Or when we're singing a song, you might know what this is like, a song, and we sing and the words speak so deeply to my life, they cut me to the core, and I hope nobody's looking. Your joy will be to follow Jesus the Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve. He spoke to Bishop Palmer briefly after that service. I did not dare ask. But I know this. I know that we pastors need reminding, perhaps on a daily basis, that our joy will not be in being served, but in serving. And I know it doesn't come naturally to many, if any of us, we who are human both before and after we are ordained. We who like it when we're noticed and rewarded and commended. We who complain when people don't understand. good deal of energy trying to make our own lives a little bit easier and to avoid more hardship or pain. Your joy will be, your joy will be to follow Jesus the Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve. And to say those words out loud, to say every word out loud, is to know deeply once again how short we so often fall of the mark. You know it. It's no different for any follower of Jesus Christ. You know it. And it only stands to reason that as you read any one of the four Gospels from beginning to end, every now and again there appears a warning label, like the one we hear today in Luke's reading. Not sure why Jesus pulls it out when he's drawing a large crowd, but just about any time Jesus is being followed by large crowds, well, it might be our inclination to say, oh, thank goodness we can use all the people we can get and go to a large crowd. You can count on Jesus to pull out something that you and I don't want. Take your family, take up your cross, give up your possessions. Now we might prefer that Jesus or someone speaking on his behalf would say something like this: bring your traditional nuclear family to church and be an admirable Christian. Whatever cross you're bearing, bring it here and lay it down and we'll make it easier for you. Come and give your life to Jesus and you'll have good fortune and peace in your heart. Maybe you've even heard that somewhere before, but if you did, I know it wasn't Jesus talking to you. I do have to give him credit, I do, for telling the truth rather than sugarcoating all of it. I know he's right. I've had troubles I've taken straight to him, and they haven't gone away yet. I've been trying to follow Jesus for quite a few years, and some days I have peace in my heart, and some days I don't. Sometimes it is a real joy to do what Jesus instructs me to do, and sometimes it's a real pain. Jesus says, when you start out on a project, don't you first sit down and count up the cost to make sure you have what you need to do. So now and then I'll hear people complain about church. Yeah, I hear this. It goes something like this. It goes, this is hard. I'm not getting my needs met. I'm tired of being asked to do things. People aren't doing what I want them to do, or saying what I want them to say, or treating me the way I want to treat. And I listen to this politely as I can and think to myself, yeah, I know. Did we forget to put the warning label on this? Did somebody bring you in here and forget to tell you that following Jesus probably wasn't going to be a cakewalk? Or have you been at it so long like I have that maybe you just forgot? Hate your family. Carry your cross. Give up your possessions. Family in the ancient Mediterranean culture was about everything a person had. An individual's identity, security, and honor were completely enfolded, not in self, but in family. And so to give up any of that was to be on your own, to be essentially vulnerable and at risk. Jesus is on his way to the cross. He's on his way to Jerusalem, where he is going to give everything up that he has and does. And he says to the crowds, he says, there's a cross for you too. There is. There's something you're called to do to get out of yourself and get over yourself. He's talking to me now. and to make life better for somebody else for a while. Follow me. And if that isn't enough, or if it is, after urging us to tally up the cost before we go sallying forth on this great adventure with Jesus, he adds, so therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all of your possessions, which I figure he's talking about everything I think I